It was the automated debt recovery scheme that saw around 400,000 vulnerable people aggressively pursued over false Centrelink debts. Put simply, Robodebt destroyed lives.
My son was in the initial stage of the pilot scheme. From mid-November through to approximately mid-January, he received letter after letter from Dun & Bradstreet. He was absolutely hounded and he committed suicide on Australia Day. Yep. He was 27.
Robodebt is a really dark story. What happened? Why did it go wrong? Because that's so evident. The commission is on task and it just needs the answers of how he understood what happened and whether he has any regret about it.
Scott Morrison was Social Services Minister when Robodebt was being planned, Treasurer when it was being implemented, and Prime Minister when it was finally scrapped after being found to be unlawful. The Royal Commission wanted to know what he knew about how such a flawed program came to be introduced and how it was allowed to run and run.
That is a matter open to interpretation,
if I may.
No, you may not, Mr. Morrison.
I think we're getting a bit bogged down in semantics.
Fair to say the former PM tested the Commission's patience.
You've effectively made submissions on the evidence, Mr. Morrison, rather than giving evidence.
Now, if you go to the last page there...
Mr. Morrison, I'm not going to the last page.
Mr. Morrison, please, just listen to the question.
Mr. Morrison, please, Mr. Morrison. The last 10 minutes has been consumed because the simple answer, no, has strayed off in other areas.
I'm available to the Commission.
Well, you might not be available tomorrow.
Are you listening at all?
Among the terse exchanges, Morrison reiterated he had no reason to believe the program was unlawful.
The use of income averaging was followed by numerous governments over decades. No one, no stakeholder, was raising any concern.
Morrison emphasising he was motivated by a sense of fairness and the need for budget repair.
The system needs to be fair to those who receive benefits as well as those who pay for them, the taxpayers.
But there was no acknowledgement of the destruction wrought on his watch.
In some senses, we won't ever fix Robodebt. We can only listen to the voices of those who suffered. And those are the voices we need to hear.
Well, Kath Madgwick's son Jared was caught up in the Robodebt scandal and he took his own life in 2019. Kath joins us now. Kath, can you tell us a little bit about Jared's experience?
Jared had been down in Victoria. He'd taken on a traineeship in which he'd been bullied. So he left that position because that was starting to impact his mental health. Jared then, you know, split up with his girlfriend and ended up homeless down there. So he then contacted me to come back to live with me at the Glasshouse Mountains. So on the evening of the 29th of May, Jared come into me very distressed that his Centrelink application had been rejected. So we had two lengthy phone calls with Centrelink on the 30th, which is the day my son took his life. There was no mention of any debt. Around 4:45 that afternoon, Jared came out very distressed, saying that now he wasn't going to get paid because he owed them $2,000. And from there, he started to just get into a distressed state. And then he left the house. So I think it was about 36 hours later, after I'd called the police and that type of thing, I realised he'd taken his life.
I mean, Kath, it's such a heartbreaking story. Obviously, that call, the assumption is that call happened in the afternoon. That was one of the Robodebt calls.
I haven't got to the end of that yet, Chris, but my suspicion is it was an administration error because he had put his income in on the 28th.
Right. Yeah, Kath, you've said previously that you're looking for accountability out of these hearings. Do you feel like you're getting that?
Not from Scott Morrison today. There seemed to be a lot of talk about how many ministries he'd been in and a lot of, Parliament talk, but no real answers today. I think the Royal Commission's doing a great job, but today was, that was something else. For me, I think there was a point where he said, you know, we needed to get all this money back to give it to people that need it. And he mentioned pensioners, but he didn't mention the youth that are often in casual jobs and, in uni and trying to to make ends meet. So I kind of felt really offended by that, that he felt that... It kind of felt like he was saying my son wasn't entitled to a payment.
Kath, you're friends with other people who have been affected by this. What would justice look like for all of you?
To have some sort of accountability. Obviously, I don't think that whoever's responsible for this should be in the Department of DHS or the DSS or Parliament. But I think ultimately the greatest outcome for us would be for the system to change so that this doesn't happen to another mother.
Kath, we really appreciate your time. We know it's been a really long day and it's a really emotional thing to talk about, so thank you so much.
No problems. Thank you.
And if you find yourself in need of help for any reason, crisis support is available 24/7 through Lifeline on 1300 114.